in COVID-19 meeting called order. So Sunil Sanglaji enavaru ivattin disa ee vishayavagi maatadtare. So Sunil Shankala Jain, ನಮ್ ಪಾಸ್ ಪ್ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟ್, ನಮ್ ಸೀನಿಯರ್ ಚೇಂಬರ್ಗೆ ಇಮಿಡಿಯೇಟ್ ಪಾಸ್ ಪ್ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟ್, ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಜೆಸಿ ಒಳಗೆ ತರಬೇತುದಾರ ಆಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವರು ಇವತ್ತಿನ ದಿವಸ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಮನಿ ಮ್ಯಾಟರ್ಸ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಫುಲ್ ಡೀಟೇಲ್ಸ್ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಓವರ್ ಟು ಸುನಿಲ್ ಸಂಕ್ಲಾ ಜೈನ್.
ಎಸ್, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಚೇರ್ಮನ್. ಸುನಿಲ್ ಸಂಕ್ಲಾ ಜೈನ್, ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್.
ಸರ್, ಕ್ರೀಡ್ ಬೇಕಲ್ಲ.
Yes,
sir. Okay.
Good evening to all of you.
Yeah.
Voice along with me.
Yeah.
We believe that age is only a cipher, a number for record.
Number of record.
That man cannot retire his experience. That he must.
He must be a paragon.
Be a paragon.
Of.
That he
perfect
that
citizenship.
That man cannot retire his experience, that he must use it responsibly and actively, and that he must be a paragon of perfect citizenship.
Citizenship.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for the privilege in introducing a person who was born on 9th June 1966 and continues his journey.
Yeah.
During his initial years, completed his academics in commerce and to sustain was a leading supplier to defense organizations, then ventured into electrical business and to help citizens achieve their future goals, became a certified financial consultant. Learning, loving, caring, sharing ideology got him associated with numerous organizations. Served JC of India as a national director training, hosted JC India National Convention, and qualified as Excel trainer. He has been recognized as outstanding officer in various organizations. He graduated as Excel trainer from JCI. He has conducted numerous training programs for corporates, educational institutions, and various NGOs. Friends, now I want to share some of the programs held under his leadership along with the Indian Senior Chamber members as president for the year 2019-20. He is instrumental in conducting regular monthly executive meetings without missing. Family picnic programs focusing on seed ball preparations and planting of about 6,000 saplings during the last year. Monthly homeless programs at Akshata Asaktara Posakara Sabha. Community service activities along with our senior Ashok Ji and Kamaldeep Ji, like free health checking camps, general, dental, cancer, high and gynecology, and food relief programs. Further, food relief contributions in the form of medicines worth about 16.4 lakhs, distribution of bed sheets to the needy, launching of e-trainers guide, conducting yoga day at the supervision of our national director programs senior MR Jaisha and Basuraj Dindur sir, conducted national president theme program Value the Values for the school, college students and open jailmates prisoners, and so many programs to add. The list is only illustrative and not exhaustive.
I think health is wealth, and if we are healthy, we are wealthy. And in COVID times, I think with this premise that health is wealth, I take this session forward. And this session is just going to be touching on, I think most of you are aware to what's happening around us. And in the last 3 months that we have gone through, and we have understood what Corona is all about. and how we are facing Corona in times of lockdown, staying at home. So it's crisis is a good time to build culture. People will remember what you do for them in these moments. I think these were the last 3 months, and going forward, we do not know to what time that we would go through in facing this crisis and challenging situation. And in times of this, it is members that we together join hands to care and share. The session would briefly be on the economy across the globe, India, and touching our homes and families. And lastly, we'll touch on the personal finance, though within a short time span of 40 minutes to an hour, it's very difficult to cover the money matters that would touch our lives. But I'll try my best to cover as much as possible to understand what's happening around us, and then take it to how we could use our resources to secure our health as well as wealth. As you're aware that COVID-19 pandemic has not just endangered millions of lives across the globe, but it has also started to disrupt the global economy. Countless people have lost their jobs or sources of income, while many others have been asked to take a pay cut. Economies have been pushed into a recession, and markets have seen years' worth of profits booked by the investors getting wiped off in a few days. In just a difficult situation, you need to take extreme precaution to protect both your health and your wealth from getting adversely impacted by the outbreak. I think the situation is such that we are impacted by everybody. In fact, the place that we live in, at home front, to our professional life, or in case if we are working, or we are having our own business, or whatsoever, whether we are working or we are retired, it still impacted our life in some way or the other. Now, this extended home stay will help us analyze what you really need versus what you want. I think there are two different aspects to what our needs are and what our wants are. And I'm sure this last 3 months, it has given time for us to introspect, to assess ourselves, and to prepare our calendar for the month and the months to come ahead. In case those who have still not done, I think it's an opportunity going forward to sit down with your family members and prepare to what your needs and wants are. The focus of most businesses today are now on protecting employees, understanding the risk to their businesses, and managing the supply chain disruptions caused by the efforts to contain the spread of COVID-19. We still do not know what is the impact of this epidemic on our businesses or on our professional life or the supply chains that we are all surrounded with. I think you're aware that the exodus of migrants and people leaving the cities to their hometowns has really disrupted, though we are still not aware to that amount of impact that we will have to bear as days go by. So now, I think, as I said, we should join our hands to care and share for a safer world. And I think it begins with us as we go forward. Businesses in sectors such as tourism, hospitality, entertainment, and air transportation have been particularly harder in the short term. As you're aware, that in the last 3 months, we have not had the aviation industry taking off. The hotels and restaurants have been closed. The multiplexes have been closed. Movie theaters have been closed. And road transport is also being closed. And to add up, there are many more things that have been closed, and they have been hit very hard in the short term. Businesses in the consumer goods and retail may also be at hit higher than the normal financial risk, especially with those high exposure to China and those in seasonal businesses where demand may be lost as opposed to be shifted, such as perishable consumer goods and seasonal apparel. I think most of the goods that we have been hearing since prior to our Prime Minister Modi's call and appeal to be local and vocal, I think we have been used to the Chinese products, and it has gone inroads to our homes and offices, and living without it has become so difficult. So, and with China being locked down, their industries being closed, and no businesses and no imports that are coming in, I think it has really impacted the businesses across and impacted our own lives also. Even commodity-oriented industries such as metals and mining or oil and gas are exposed as global demands shift and pricing fluctuates. We have seen how the fuel prices dropped to rock bottom, and there were no takers since industries were closed, and there was no consumption. And to that also, the economy has been impacted. A classic economic crisis with a twist. The current crisis, similar to the 2008 recession, has thrown off many consumers' traditional shopping patterns. Take grocery shopping. In the early days of pandemic, consumers loaded their pantries, made fewer shopping trips, visited fewer stores each week, and targeted their spending on essentials. Consumers have also tried new retailers and new brands during the crisis, possibly shifting the loyalty dynamics within the retail sector. We have seen this. We are back to our mohalla shops, our small petty shops for our daily needs. We have moved away from those malls and branded stores for all our purchases. I think there's a big shift to how we have been shopping earlier and now how are we shopping. I think this has also thrown a lot of retail industry, the malls and the big brands into a very bad shape. But the COVID-19 crisis, unlike the past economic disruptions, brings a new layer of complexity. The severe threat to consumers' health and safety. Consequently, the pandemic has amplified and accelerated the consumer behavior we have seen in times of crisis. For example, during the 2008 recession, financially strapped consumers drastically reduced their spending on out-of-home dining. But during this pandemic lockdown, restaurants dining has come to a standstill, as physical distancing and stay-at-home orders in many regions force consumers to eat practically all their needs at home. So from last 2.5-3 months, none of us have gone to any restaurants, hotels, or outings. And such are the examples that many places are thrown out of business. The impact of COVID-19 hasn't been uniform across the country because of differences in both virus spread and government regulation. Geographic variability in consumer sentiment is therefore likely to persist and potentially even widen, which means that retailers will need to vary their value strategies by region. I think across the globe, the scenario is the same, that the retailers need to work out new strategies, new businesses have to work out new strategies to reach out to their consumers, their suppliers, right from the manufacturers to the consumers. The strategies need to be reworked by all and everybody. Boldly exploring innovative tactics in promotions, pricing, and assortment will be the paramount for responding to the changing needs of consumers. I think it is a big challenge before any businesses, any industry today, to adopt to newer ways how they could promote their products, regain back the customers that they've lost, regain back the market share that they were holding earlier, regain the loyalty to the brands, regain the loyalty and the taste for the products which was there earlier, where last 3 months or so, or a little more than across the globe, people have moved their priorities, their taste, their needs and their wants. Everything has been changed. So regaining back to what they were doing earlier and what they would be doing now, it requires a lot of working in the back office, in their back office rooms, to ensure that the strategies are in place as India has started unlocking and the globe is also unlocking and opening up the economy. And by the time they put things in place, it's still a long way to go. We are all spending a disproportionate amount of time trying to figure out how the world will be after Corona saga. We do not know how the world would be post Corona. Corona is still not out, still not away, and we still do not know how things will shape up even tomorrow. Some are romanticizing work from home. Some fear the deepest recession. Some imagine complete government control of our lives and return of local community-based living. We just do not know. I think, what are we going to do tomorrow? Either we are going to be controlled. Every day we see that new government SOPs are in place. New guidelines are coming in place. Every day is changing. Today it's unlocking, tomorrow it is lockdown. Tomorrow we do not know whether the area that we are living, is that a containment zone, or our houses or the complexes that we are going to live is going to be sealed down, or whether the offices that we are working to are going to be sealed, or the businesses that we are running that is going to be open. We are living in very uncertain times and very challenging times going forward. As Albert Einstein said, in the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. And this COVID-19 crisis may have negative consequences on your finances, but there are some, there may be some silver linings. So we need to look at opportunities. Look at your budget to see how your spending habits have changed during the stay at home orders. You could be saving a significant amount of money if you are not. I think in the last 3 months plus, you have stopped going to restaurants, so that is a saving. You were traveling, you have saved on that. You were enjoying the family and friends, some outings, weekend outings or vacations, you have saved on that. You are commuting daily for work, you have saved on that. You have saved on that fuel cost or the transportation cost. You were always on an impulsive buying as you would have entered into a grocery store. Whether you just wanted a kg of rice, probably you would have picked up many more things along with that. So that was impulsive buying, so that you have saved. Now, getting into the malls and getting to that window shopping, that shopping for those new clothes or the fancy items or things which was not a necessity, and you just carry your bags full of goods from those complexes and malls and big showrooms. You have saved on all that cost. I think that is a huge saving that you have gone through. Sorry, I think I'm jumping on the slides. Now it is time to keep focus on the present. Preserve yourself and your household and handle that money you have very carefully. I think till now, before the coronavirus that brought the world to a standstill, you used to spend money without any breakdowns or speed barriers like sort of thing, or stopping at, okay, and this is the amount that I need to spend. You're just emptying your pocket, using your debit card, credit card, and loans and everything. So those days are gone. Now you need to make a list before you head out to do your shopping. You start from your kitchen. That is the most necessary today. and that is the most needed thing that you need to survive. Because before you head to make your shopping for your groceries, prepare a list to what is your requirements. Before heading out, walk through your kitchen, look at what you're running low and what you need for the week. Also consider how much space you have. Earlier you used to store, so now you need to look at what is the space that is that you need to buy. If you can, make the list organized by the area of the store that you would visit. If you're looking at your mohalla shop or a community area, you have a grocery shop, look at what is the item that he has got in stock, prepare a list accordingly, and then step out. This will help minimize your time when you go up to the store. Rather than looking across the shelves, probably the list would be handy to know what you want. Plan out your dinners for the week. This helps you determine exactly what you need at the store and can then include those ingredients to your list. This will help you reduce buying food that may go bad. So probably some food items that you may just require for the next couple of days, just pick up those items. Don't pick up items that you could store in the refrigerator and then it goes out, gets sorted out and thrown. So you avoid wastage totally. Then shop online, try to shop online. Buy your groceries online. I think there are many online stores that are open now to deliver your groceries and get it delivered or use the pickup services. It's easier that way to stick up your list, plus another way to stay away from crowds and keep away from corona infection. I think it's easier when with your family, at your with your mobile app or on your laptop or desktop. I think you have the complete items that you could select and then order online. How are Indian households coping under the COVID lockdown? I've just jotted down the numerous points that we have been impacted during lockdown. I've just given a few points. One is the lost income. One is the survival factor. And the hardest hit is rural households. It's not that the urban households are not harder. Urban households are also harder. And there's an interesting survey that I would like to share with you. That there was a survey done by a reputed company who found that house lost income, 84% reported fall in their income due to the lockdown. That was also due to sharp unemployment and decrease in workforce. And current unemployment is risen to 25.5% as on May 5th. Which was 7.4% on March 21st. So unemployment is rising, though we're just reading and it's not put on media or widely circulated, but unemployment is rising by the day. So this has given us loss of income to numerous families. And the survey also says that 34% of the households have reported of being able to survive for not more than a week. That is shocking, because if 34% can only sustain for not more than a week, they would require special assistance. Now that special assistance could come through bank loans, through help from their family or friends, or they'll have to borrow money or try ways and means to sustain themselves. So this is also a matter of concern that 34% of the households today are not going to be able to survive for more than a week on their own. Now, rural households, around 88% of the rural households repeat fall in their income compared to 75% of the urban households. So going forward, and if the situation remains the same, I think it is tough times ahead. And government, though they have declared a big whopping 20 lakh crores package, I think the experts in the coming programs would like Senior M.R. Jayashaw is going to conduct a session, and I think he will throw more light on this 20 lakh crore package, how you and me would benefit, or how the industry would benefit, or how India would benefit, and how are the ways and means of this distribution, and the modalities of all that would be shared by Senior M.R. Jayashaw in his coming session. I will not go deep into it because it's a very vast subject, and if we get into this, we get entangled of what's going to happen. So I would rather give more time on the personal finances and how it could help us individually, and how we could save, and how we could plan our finances going forward. So I will not talk on the bigger industrial part, or the MSMEs, or other areas where the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister have declared those packages. And though you have read it in the newspapers, and probably those who are into those industries or businesses or sectors that you would benefit, I think definitely you have better points and viewpoints and to understand those subjects better. One more point before that, I think most of this 3 months, I think including me, I'm not aloof of this. I think we should stay away from junk food. I think we have spent a lot of money on junk food rather than on more of sattvic food. We are all mindlessly eating. We are at home without our usual routine, spending a lot of time wandering the house. There's been nowhere to go. Too often we find ourselves in the kitchen and think, might as well we have a snack. We are not eating because we are hungry. We are eating because we are bored. And chips, muffins, cookies, candies, and whatnot are more appealing as boredom snack than rather having a plate of salad. I think I could see laughing faces, and we are all used to it in the last 3 months. So don't buy those boredom snacks. That's another tip that will make your wallet and health happy. So what are the steps that I take to restore my financial health? I think we should take a notepad, sit down, make a list of every area where you are spending your money and where you can begin to cut. Some obvious ones right now are going out to eat and travel. These are the major expenses that we have on hand. Use those funds to pay down your credit card debt, if any. I think the first thing that if you have the surplus money, I think you should pay off your credit card debts, because credit card debts are the costliest that you pay on interest. The other thing that suggesting people to do while stuck at home is what I call smiling and dialing. I think probably try to work on new novel ideas of calling up people, expanding your business on through telephone, work through that, and use those novel methods of earning that extra money. And probably the circle of us, like Senior Chamber, I think we could use this connectivity of reaching out and helping our own colleagues and friends in our own region and regions outside. And if you want to expand, probably Indian Senior Chamber is another very big, wider area where we could understand and see how we could benefit financially. And at times of COVID, I think this is the only way that we could start expanding our business to newer horizons. The COVID-19 pandemic and its economic impact have taken a toll on businesses, jobs and incomes, as I said, forcing many to reconsider their financial situation and priorities. This change is also reflected in the way people save and borrow. The survey released on 9 June showed that people have become more conservative when it comes to their financial priorities. the discretionary spending falling and saving, investing and loan repayment rising to the top of the list. This survey was conducted by Money Mood COVID. When asked what their topmost financial priority would be after the pandemic, it is very interesting. 52% said saving, investment and debt payment. 24% said household expenses, utilities and education. And 13% said healthcare and insurance. In contrast, only 11% responded saying personal spending, education and entertainment would be their priority. So now you see the shift of the priorities, what was pre-corona times and now corona times, the priorities have changed, the percentages have also reversed accordingly. The financial fallout from the COVID-19 pandemic has resulted in far-reaching consequences for many. The survey shows, in spite of reducing the expenses, a staggering 82% of respondents foresee problems in making ends meet. To tide over the crisis, they are seen to be actively looking for personal loans, even as they repay existing debt. With the lockdown coming to an end and the virus said to be part of our lives, it is imperative for individuals to take stock of their financial situation and plan for the times ahead. As I said, it is tough times ahead, challenging times ahead. I think many would be going to distressed times also. And I'm confident that if, as a team, as members and friends, if you could get together and probably if you have any concerns or if you have any issues, whether it is personal, financial or social, I think you need to go on to a mentoring or probably share your thoughts with a good friend and probably seek his advice. Or probably we have experts in our own region and probably friends outside our region also who could come to our help, advise us accordingly, suggest things, probably our family friends or probably our relatives, whomever you could think about. Probably they could come of some rescue to you and probably counsel and help during this tough times going forward. And probably I have a suggestion. Those who are well-to-do off, probably who have ample, comfortable, probably, and there is any person coming in or any friend coming in, probably extend a helping hand to such colleagues and friends. Probably we don't understand because these are times where financially you will get into depression. One is the health concern outside because you cannot step outside due to COVID. And one at the being in-house and within the four walls, it is very tough for us to gel with situations because everybody has got their own mental instabilities also. And many things that is going across their minds, how to sustain and survive going forward. Borrowings with commercial banks have the highest share in households' financial liabilities today. At the end of quarter four of 2019-20, outstanding loans availed by households from commercial banks accounted for the bulk of the total financial liabilities. That is whopping 75.9%, followed by HFCs, NBFCs, cooperative banks, and credit societies. So you see that almost 76% today is personal loans borrowed from commercial banks. And commercial loans don't come at low cost. And it is a heavy cost and they are burdened. So basically, with no earnings, loss of income, and loans mounting on individuals, things are going to be getting more difficult as days go by. But also compelling is the pileup of the economic misery the lockdown has brought. In the latest quarter ended on April 20th, India's GDP grew the slowest in 11 years at 3.1% and is expected to contract by 6.8% in the current fiscal year. And various government agencies and international agencies have given different percentages and different views. But one thing is certain, that we are going to be negative going forward. And if not for negative, probably we're not going to see growth in the coming months as we go forward. So what do? We need to limit discretionary spending. So how can you do that? Don't spend on things you can live without. I think that purchases that we used to go pre-corona times, and things that we used to buy, impulsive buying, that I think put brakes onto it. So what we don't need, I think we don't buy it today. We each have different definitions of what is essential. For some, it could be abstaining from food deliveries. For some, it could be shopping less online. And each one would have their own definitions and mindsets and thinking, or the guidelines of what is essential and what is not essential. We use what you already have. You may discover some hidden gems at the back of your closet. I think minimalism is the order of the day today. I think it is time that your clutter is out of your homes. I think we need to look at what is required, keep that. Which is not required, if you're able to dispose it off, probably convert that into cash. And once, I think, spend some time in your homes to understand what is there in your closets. And probably, surely, you'll find so many things that you feel that are not using it for years, or probably ages, and probably it has to be disposed. Probably it would have grown in value also. So think about it. Now, the savings part of it. I think we Indians, and as we members, many of us are used to savings right from our childhood, or the family system has given us that mantra of savings for these days. And I think many of us have had savings, and it is a good thing that you have done. And some would have done savings for tax implications. Some would have done savings, whether they were in the government companies or agencies. They would have saved through the government agencies, through life insurance or EPF or any other modes that the government would have given them. So keep focus on the present. Preserve yourself and your household. And handle that money you have very carefully, because this is the only thing that you have. Maintain an adequate emergency fund. I don't know how many of us maintain an emergency fund. The thumb rule is that you should have, at least if you have been working, you need to have 6 months of your salary as your emergency fund. And those in businesses, 6 months of income as your emergency fund. I don't know how many of you have this emergency fund with you as on date. I think if you don't have it, I think it's a serious concern that we need to look at of creating this emergency fund or pool in that emergency fund, because as the days go by, the cost that we have to keep for the medical emergencies that we could face is going to be very, very high. And the interest that you're going to pay for your loans is going to be very, very high. In case the income is not going to substantiate to the loans that you have taken to pay back for those EMIs or even the interest, we need to have those emergency fund handy. And for your day-to-day expenses also, in case going forward we do not know how the situation would emerge, whether the businesses were going to improve, whether we are going to be back on the jobs, whether the pay cuts that have already happened or probably would come back to the normal pay scale, or probably we may have further pay cuts, we are not sure. I think nobody is in a situation to guarantee such situations that your income is going to be stable, or this is the income that you've been generating this month, or probably this percentage could be a cutoff. I think this emergency fund of 6 months that you would have is going to be of great rescue as we go forward. Exercise strict budgeting measures. To be able to free up your money for essential financial commitments like building an emergency fund, paying your rents, EMIs, utilities, insurance premiums, etc. during this phase, you also need to exercise strict cost-cutting measures. Now, the lockdown might have helped in cutting down certain expenses, like daily commutes, and this should help in boosting your savings. So prioritize your expenses and cut down heavily on non-essential spends. So strictly put on paper your budget. Life and health insurance should also be a priority. As you are aware that life insurance would give you 15 days grace period to pay your premiums, or a month's grace period subject to some private companies and whatever the companies of insurance companies are given the guidelines. You have that grace period to pay. If you fail to pay those premiums on time, your life insurance policy lapses, which you shouldn't allow it to do it. And the health insurance companies do not give you grace period, to best of my knowledge. And you will have to pay it before the deadlines and the expiry of that premium paying time. So you need to be prepared for paying your insurance premiums, which is most needed in such times, because your life insurance, your term plans, your personal accident insurance policies, your health insurance policies, your critical illness policies, all those insurance policies, whichever that you have, I think is a must that you need to keep it alive, to keep it, to ensure that you have sustainability of any eventualities going forward, or your untimely demise, which your dependent family would have to face a financial loss going forward. So please ensure that you have sufficient insurance. I'm sure most of us are seniors, those who are running the life insurance policies, and probably you should continue keeping it. And I don't know whether they should be able to pay, get life insurance at this age, and the premium that they are going to pay for the insurance cover, that we'll have to be very, very high. And those who have medical insurance, very good. If you have very little medical insurance, I think you should top it up to take it to at least minimum of 5 lakh rupees of medical insurance that is required in case of any medical emergencies going forward. Because looking at the COVID treatment and the cost that we are reading in the newspapers and the hospitals that would charge, with no cap by the government for the private hospitals in Karnataka at least, and some states have already gotten the cap of the cost that the private hospitals could charge the patients. I think it is going to be very hard to understand what is the cost that we'll have to bear once we get admitted to the hospital, or probably we get into quarantine. And probably yesterday I was reading through the news that in US, a person who was there in the hospital for 75 days had to shell out around crores of rupees. And he said, why did I sustain to be living? Probably I wouldn't have been there. And he had to pay around, I don't know if I could have read it properly or remember, it was around 8 crores of rupees that his hospital bills piled up. So this is the hospital expenses that could befall on us. And probably you may have your aged parents, or probably you could have somebody who is ailing in your residence, or amongst your relatives, or amongst your friends, probably you may require that much of additional money to take care of those hospitalization and bills. In case those are working and you have an medical insurance through your company or corporate, probably it's time that the corporate is allowing you, please top up your insurance plans. In case if you're having your wife, spouse covered, very good. In case you don't have your spouse or parents, coverage is not there in the corporate health plan, please get your spouse and dependent to those group medical insurance provided by your company or the corporate. And there's also a situation in case you are jobless, and till now you were looking at that I have a medical insurance plan given by my company, and you're out of job and you lose that medical insurance cover also. You are without medical insurance cover. So I think you should look at standalone medical plan for your family, and you should go for it. Now, a couple of companies have also come out with exclusive COVID insurance, medical insurance. Probably it starts from 25,000 rupees to 2 lakh rupees sum assured, and it starts from 550 rupees to 2,500 rupees. I'm just giving you an approximate premium figure. Please check with the insurance companies in case you would like to buy your standalone COVID plan. So that exclusive COVID plan, insurance gives you one-time payment in case you are positive. And please read the fine prints by the company who is providing these plans. Try not to discontinue your essential investments. I think many of you are into habit of investing every month or yearly investment or small savings, either in post offices or banks, to recurring deposits or mutual funds through SIPs or any other form of investments that you have been comfortable. I think you have been doing those investments. If you are comfortable doing those investments, please do not stop those investments that you have been doing from all those years, because you have been doing it for your future financial goals. And to ensure those financial goals, as you are aware, that you have a compounding effect on your long-term goals or investments. So basically, they compound. So if you break those investments, you lose out on your future goals planning. So in case you have to break for any situation, do take, the government has given you a provision to take some percentage out of your provident fund, or probably close the provident fund which you are already dissociated with the companies. Please read the fine prints. Probably your certified financial consultant could come to your rescue, or consult a certified financial consultant who could advise you accordingly on your future goals and your investment plans, and probably which investments that you need to break in case of any emergencies as on today or in next 15 days or a month. So which policies or which investments or which provident funds or which SIPs or which mutual funds which you should break first, so that you gain maximum and don't lose out on your investments which you have already done. As you're aware that the banks have also brought down the interest on your savings today, whether it is provident fund or whether it is your savings account or whether it is your FDs, they have brought down on your savings today. So read and consult your financial consultant who could advise you accordingly. Borrow with caution. I think today, earlier we just used to borrow left, right, center, and the lending company sitting down in the malls, on the entrance of the doors of the showroom, used to run around. We have finance schemes, this scheme, that scheme, the credit card companies. I think seriously, you should stop to borrowing at this point of time. Avoid borrowing as far as possible, whether it is, and the credit card borrowing should be the last that you should do. And borrowing from the banks to commercial borrowings or the personal loans should be second last. Probably look at within your own home, whether the savings that you are holding in cash, use that resource first. Then move into the next resource. And then go to the last is the credit card borrowing. Use all the other means and modes of taking it without any interest cost to your borrowings. So you need to have an additional caution with all your borrowings. Have a bounce back plan ready before taking the loan more actively. You have read in newspapers or heard in the news channels and the government that have announced 3 months moratorium, 6 months moratorium on your credit card, on your housing loans, on various other loans that you have, and various other moratoriums that they have gone through. And these moratoriums need to be read very finely. You should go through the fine prints of it, consult your bank or a banker to what does it mean, and whether you have taken a moratorium, that interest whether interest will be charged on that period or not. If it is charged, then it will only mount on to your EMIs, and you will be a longer EMIs, or the EMIs cost will increase, and probably a situation will arise when you are losing out on your income, when the finances are very weak, and your interest costs and your EMIs and the banks will be behind you to pay your EMIs on time post those 3 months or 6 months of the moratorium period that the government is allowed. So banks will not stand. And if you have taken loans borrowed from the private lenders, and they will just be after you immediately after the grace period that is over. And they make the living much more miserable, much more disturbing, and the situation could only worsen, not through corona, but because of your financial situation that has put you on to these lenders or the finance companies for the borrowings that you have already taken. So try to clear your borrowings as much as possible now or during a period of time. Don't step into new borrowings at this point of time unless it is too emergent a situation. Okay. I will take up many more questions that you have going forward, because I'm sure there will be many questions that you may be pondering your mind. And probably I'm sure within the stipulated time, you may not be able to answer and give solutions. And probably interaction amongst us that we could bring solutions to the immediate needs. Now the savings, I think it is...
Hi Sunil, this is Bhaskar.
Yes, Bhaskar.
Go ahead. Right? Okay. One thing I need to compliment you is, you know, like you're completely taken on the complete, you know, like 360 degree approach on finance. I was making some points to ask a question. By the time I wrote it out, your answer is there in the next slide. So thank you for covering the, you know, the finance part in a holistic way. And it's really great. The presentation is superb. I really like the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Bhaskar. At this point of time, I think you have motivated me. I think you are one of the most experienced person across sectors, and the experience that you count, expertise that you carry, I think there's a lot of learning that I should carry from you also. Thank you, Bhaskar. Mutual fund from a long time, which has given you a very compounded annual return of 12.5%. Don't try to touch that mutual fund at this point of time. Probably you can think about the PPF, which the falling interest rates and the accumulation that you have earned over the period of time. Probably you can think of withdrawing a small portion or to the required amount from that emergent fund. So you prioritize which fund that you need to exit in such emergency. Because assets are very important, because you have taken assets for your different goals. Probably it could be your children's education, your children's marriage, or probably a retirement and such things. And nobody knew that COVID would take us by surprise, and we would be out of income, and probably our savings could go for a toss, and the cash that we could be utilizing should be getting exhausted over a period of time. And also look at the tax implications that you would get involved into the exit of such liquidation of the assets. That is also very important, because you have saved, probably you may land up paying capital gains, or probably short-term capital gains, or long-term capital gains, whatever the assets that you're holding. And every asset class has got the tax implications, because the tax that you have saved and the tax that you would exit. Only life insurance is on the exempt. And probably PPF also is on the exempt. And with new norms, probably you need to go to your financial consultant to understand the investment and the exit and the tax implications, or the tax consultant would be a better choice who could advise you on all this. Now, as I told you, that insurance is very important, and you should stay insured. And you can't compromise on your insurance. Probably if those who are not having insurance, probably tomorrow is the day to start and ensure that tomorrow morning when you get up, look at which insurance policy you should buy, the health insurance on the priority basis. Because the pandemic is going to be very costly once we are prone to it or get in contact with it. And this could hurt not only you, it is the concern about the family. Because this particular pandemic, this corona, it does not only touches your own self, it touches your complete family and we do not know who is prone to get infected and landing to the hospital. So I only pray that such situation does not arise to any of our members, our family members, and including the globe. Those who are secured, safe, continue to be secured and safe. Don't try to venture out. Don't try to experiment. Don't say that I am anti-Britain, anti-virus, because nothing is going to happen. Don't step out and go for fun, frolic, picnic sort of exposure anywhere outside. Unless there's an emergency situation, please step out. Otherwise, please do not step out. And on the flip side, I would say that those who are on the link portfolio, I think it's a great opportunity. You have many stocks or many mutual funds holding those stocks. You are on a very rock bottom pricing, and probably the right time to enter, probably the right time would have been a couple of months back. And though it should be very choosy in case you are on stock picking. Otherwise, if you're not expert on stock picking, don't venture out and lose out your money. Somebody giving you tips that this stock is going to rise in 2 months and whatsoever. Don't believe into any such tips or rumors given by anybody whatsoever. Probably otherwise park your funds into mutual funds, who are well-managed funds are there. Probably that is the right time that you could park your funds. And in case you don't park all your funds in one go, probably use the systematic investment plans that are available with most of the mutual funds. Probably use it over a period of 6 months, 12 months to park your funds. Don't put all your money in one day or any other investments for that matter. Spread your investments over a period of time, small investments. Provided you have the sufficient 6 months minimum emergency fund with you at home or in your bank available to you at any given point of time. This is also a time sitting at home to build your financial portfolio. Probably most of the finance investments or instruments that you have are available in the digital form. You convert that into a digital form. Probably you have a financial ledger on your mobile phone. Share it with your family and close relatives. Probably you could have like to have the insurance plan that you have. Write down the policy number, which company that you have, the validity of the policy, and what is covered and what is not covered. A small note and put it behind your dressing table mirror. So that is the best place that you could keep it handy so that everybody is on easy access. Because we all have, assuming that everybody has insurance policies, we don't remember the insurance policy number that we have. And most of the companies that provide cashless facilities on the insurance policies or the cash card that we have, and that is also in digital form. Assuming that if I am affected and I have to be moved to the hospital and I'm not accessible to my mobile phone in any emergency situation, how will my family be aware of that he has got an insurance and he could get the benefits to that hospital? Rather than the hospital pressurizing the family to pay huge deposits of the money on admission. So probably you could save that situation for the family, or that agony that the family would go through in getting to such given situation. So probably you have those policy numbers or the investments behind your dressing table, or anything which is handy that the family is aware or they are known of. Or probably you share it with the family who could store it in the mobile, in the digital phone. And diversify yourself. I think you should not invest in only one area. Probably you should look at small investments across asset classes. Probably gold is very high, but still, once you invested into your PPF, RDs, post office savings, SIPs, probably you could get into a DMAT form of investment. And most of your investments are available on the DMAT form, whether it is equity. Be careful of debt investments at this point of time. Probably you would have read about the Franklin Templeton situation and debt instruments which are not doing well. And I think looking at the debt investments and other investments require a lot of detailed presentations be careful about your investments in debt instruments, especially at this point of time. You can seek the experts' advice and consultation on the investments in case of debts, because we are all senior citizens. Probably many of us would have invested into debt investments, assuming that debt investments are safe and probably would give us very decent returns, little more than the fixed deposits, which is not the scenario today. But there are some debt instruments who are giving, like government securities could give you a little, it's a safe and little more higher rate of return than the FDs, provided you're willing to take the risk at that point of time. The risk appetite is also important. Probably you should not take the risk appetite more than what you are capable of. Probably if you are above 55, 60, you should not venture out into equity investments at all. Probably you should look at a very balanced thing. Probably you have a bit more in FDs and safer investments rather than looking at this risk asset class investments. And you can also look at investing if you have long-term goals and if your income flow is stable. Probably you could look at constant gold investments also on a monthly basis on a SIP route, on a DMAT form, rather than looking at the jewelry or coin buying route. Probably the DMAT is the best thing, or government sovereign bonds are also available. Probably you can look at the government sovereign bonds also, investments. So there are various platforms available for you to invest your money. And like I said, that mentally you should be prepared. Be very cool, calm, composed, and investments opportunities are there, provided you are safe to what you have. Don't risk on venturing out, which is unsafe. Don't take the clues that either equities are available to you cheap or land is available to you cheap. Nothing is cheap today. Going forward, we do not know situations. Probably we ourselves, if we are not very strong and stable and very protected financially, we may be shaken, shattered, and the family would be shaken and shattered. So don't give room and scope for such situations. Start planning today, and probably with the coming days, I think if we are calm, composed, and secure financially at home, don't venture out looking at financially strong, and it should be taken care. Every rupee spent is lost. It's not saved. So probably whether it gets into a situation which is beyond our control. So be safe, be secured, and I think keeping focus on such situations, I think I've taken ample time. I think I should leave the open forum so that I could also learn.
Any questions and answers?
Thank you, sir.
Bharat Das is on the floor.
Can I talk? Okay, thank you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Sunil, I very carefully listened to your session, and it was very neatly laid up, covered the whole aspect, all ambit of financial planning, and especially you stressed on the medical insurance and other insurance. Now that in COVID times, we have three types of expenditure. This is only an observation on my part. Three types of expenditure. The first one is essential, that we have to anyhow do it. The second one is a desirable things, little desirable things that we have to plan. All the luxuries can wait. So three types of expenditure, luxuries can wait. But during the COVID time, it is the best time for marriage. Because if you are usually spending 10 lakh for a marriage, it only takes 1 lakh rupees for a marriage. So if you are planning any marriage, it is the best time for a marriage. And regarding the income side and the insurance side, I have my own issue. Like I failed to, during this corona period, my medical insurance was not renewed on time. So after 1 month, I went there to renew it. Then there's a lot of problems, because there is always a period where which they will not cover, like heart attack and other corona and other things. or against, I have to wait for 1 year only, then some of the policies can will come into force. So wherever it is possible, timely renewals of the medical insurance is very urgent. It is very, very much required, because I am just suffering from that. And as you rightly said, the macro level, what will happen to corona? That is one issue. Will it vanish and then well, everything will be on the routine nature? Now the problem is, we are all waiting for the curve to flatten. Now what is the curve flattening? Because the input should be equal to output, then the curve will flat. What is the input? Like the persons admitted into the hospital and hospital persons released from the hospital should be equal. Now at this stage, what is happening is the person admitted to hospital is more and the person released from the hospital is less, which means the graph is going up. So we'll have to wait for some more time where the curve flattens, and then some more time for the curve to come down. Only country, New Zealand, I think, is the only country which has survived the last patient of corona. We will, in India, we will take more time. So we have to adjust to the situation. Now regarding the type of investment, as rightly suggested by you, where should we invest? This is hard-earned money. Where should we invest for almost all the senior citizens? This is one point we have to take into account. Now the investment opportunities are very less because the share is coming down. The share price is coming down, and we cannot wait for when it will come up. We will take one example. We will take only one example of Ambani's. Now the India's richest man is Ambani, who Mukesh Ambani. But his brother, younger brother, was equally rich. What happened to him? He has the same background, same backing, and same amount of money with him also. But he is now bankrupt. So we cannot say that the market to know what market can go up and where to invest and where we should not invest. This is still, we have to think on. Now coming to the interest rate, in almost all the foreign countries, the loan rate has gone down from 5% to 1.5%. It was 5 to 6, and it has gone down to 1.5% after the during the COVID period. Now it will happen to India's. The rate of borrowing will come down. Will be always for agriculture, the Kisan card and other things, where the rate of interest is still subvented by the government of India. Wherever possible, we can take loan for agriculture. It is, the rate of interest will range from 3 to 4%. So all the rest, you know, personal income and other things will demand a higher rate of interest. These are some of the observations I have to commit. In a 3 billion economy, we are all looking for a 5 billion economy. Now there is a crush with our borders in Pakistan and China. And with the COVID also, our economy, one third of the economy is already lost by the last 4 months. So there will be, the petrol prices are going up. The government is finding very difficult to meet the budget requirements. So the financial situation as on now is very volatile, and it is beyond prediction, like the corona itself. So as rightly put by Jane, what I would also suggest is, don't put all the eggs in one basket. Put all our eggs in different baskets, so that sometime when crush comes, some of the basket we will have the eggs. Thank you, Bangalore and Shiv Prasad, for giving me this opportunity.
You were talking about Jan Dhan and Jeevan Bima, where with the 12 rupees, you know, accidental insurance of 2 lakhs is covered. With around 250 rupees, life insurance is covered to an extent of 2 lakhs and all. But unfortunately, it is not reaching the people the way it is expected. That is one side. But otherwise, you have covered what situation we are, COVID, what should be done, spending, saving, budget, and what are the, you know, how we look at the future and all. That's really a wonderful session. And again, you have impressed upon the tax structure also. Tax, this capital gains tax and all. Most of the people do not know. If you sell or purchase the property now, when the IT will question you, we don't know. Now anyway, because of the digital or technology, everything is very, very transparent. But people are not aware. Still, people are not aware. But definitely in this situation, your presentation is very, very timely, very nice. I'm impressed and congratulations. And I'm happy some of the NGO members, apart from Bharatdas ji, Shaul ji is there, and some of our neighboring legions, Bharat Rao,
Nazim,
Chavan, and then our Divakar from Enarpura, then Kalandar, Dadapir are all participating, very, very happy. And some of the members from our members have participated. I compliment Srinivas and Srivatsa for a wonderful effort, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think
you also Srinil, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Hi. In today's scenario, real estate has always been a good investment long-term basis. But now we are not sure next 3 years, 5 years, how this sector is going to function, because it's very capital intensive and people only have only notional value, right? I bought the site at 1,000 rupees, now it's 5,000 rupees. Unless you realize and somebody has to be there to buy it and then only you can get the money. So in this condition, what's your advice? If I have a real estate property, is it better to get rid of that and put the money into some good safe investment like mutual funds or whatever it is?
Simplicity and they use some word that is beautiful.
You call me a little.
I ever like that.